The new aspect of our society is network society. We have defined society in linguistics, we have defined society in sociology. However, what we need to include, and at no cost in modern time can we exclude, is network society. It is a spaceless. Members of a network society do not live in one place. And it has various types of impact on language. It's a new phenomena, relatively newer phenomena, and it is going to impact many aspects of our lives in the coming days. We want to look at a relationship between language and network society. And through network society, we also include media and then the changing language in the context of media and network society is what is another emerging area in applied linguistics that we need to understand. Media and network society together and the role of language in these two has emerged and created a huge potential for discussions in change, and the changing perspective of language has visible implications, and that we need to account for in order to understand applied linguistics, that is the issues in applied linguistics. Some of the things that we need to understand is network society itself and its implications and changes in language for the newly emerging society. What consists of natural network society? We know about natural language that is spoken in our society, and the way language is used in network society is what we want to look at, and for that we want to invite Dr. Om Prakash of the Gautam Buddha University to share his perspectives on how we understand network society for applied linguistics perspectives.
We are talking about language, media and society. And I'm sure majority of the audience comprises of young people, students. So I'll go by a little storytelling before I get to the main topic. If you look at the human history, start with agrarian age, because before that there's no point talking. So if you look at the march of civilization from agrarian age to industrial age, to service industry, then information technology, and next wave is predicted to be the age of nanotechnology. And these are not simple terms. They have encoded socio-cultural history of human civilization. Each phase and each milestone in the history has its own a very elaborate development. The three terms here, language, media and network society. You all understand media, so I will not be elaborating upon that. You all know language, and I go by the etymological definition of language. I don't want to talk about language as a social phenomena, because you are all familiar. So I'll be talking about network society and also talking about the implications for language use in network society. So this talk is about language in network society. Most of you may be familiar with network society, term network society. Perhaps it was coined in Japan in 1960s, Ito reports it 1973, when, and also a proposal by Daniel Bell, who talks about the post-industrialist society, coming of a post-industrialist society. So this term, network society, and it was documented very extensively by Manuel Castle in 3 volumes. So we begin with that. The term information society is claimed to have originated in Japan in 1960s, and the coming of post-industrial society, what Daniel Bell made a claim. He also uses the same term, and linguists like Vanjik and Castle, who is a sociologist, they prefer to call it network society. Whether we call it network society or information society, we are talking about a different society altogether inherited from post-industrial development. And this society is not a kind of physical society we're all familiar with and we live in. This society is a reconfigured society beyond boundaries and beyond the limitations of time. The structural changes in new social order in the backdrop of exponential growth in communication technology is a very comprehensive document in 3 volumes by Manuel Castle. And it says the information age, economy, society, and culture. You can go and get details of it. But this is how he defines network society. A society whose social structure is made of networks powered by microelectronic-based information and communication technology. By social structure, I understand the organizational arrangements of humans in relations of production, consumption, experience, and power expressed in meaningful communication coded by culture. This is what Manuel Castle defines network society as. If you want to look at the size and reach of this digitally connected society, there's a survey by We Are Social, August 2015, done in India. And out of total population of 1285 million, a total of 350 million people are on active internet users. 134 million people are active social media users. 590 million people are unique mobile users. 97 million people are active mobile social users in India. And if you look at the population size and the kind of platforms they are using now, 53% of the total population that I talked about is on Facebook. 44% are WhatsApp users. 40% surf on Google. 34% have Twitter accounts. 29% are connected with LinkedIn. 19% are on Instagram. 18% connect through WeChat. 17% are Pinterested. 12% share on Tumblr, and 11% Snapchat users. So this is the size and volume of the members of this network society in India. This is data from India. Now, if you look at the future of this digital growth, recently launched program by this present central government, Digital India Program. And if you look at the objective of this program, so they have set a goal for 2019, and they want to achieve a broadband in 2.5 lakhs villages, universal phone connectivity, net zero imports by 2020, 400,000 public internet access points, Wi-Fi in 2.5 lakhs schools, all universities, public Wi-Fi hotspot for citizens, digital inclusion, 1.7 crore trained for IT, telecom and electronic jobs. Job creation, direct job creation, 1.7 crores, and indirect, 8.5 crores. E-governance and e-services across all government operations. And India to be leader in ITUs in services, health, education, banking, and digitally empowered citizens, public cloud and internet access. This is an ambitious plan by Government of India. Now, you can see a parallel digital society that we are creating. And my focus is on this interface, language used in real society, in the forms we use in real life and real society, and also the language forms and the contents that are present and being used and consumed in this digital space. So I'll be negotiating between these two, virtual and real space. This is what I am going to talk about. The exponential growth and digital connectivity has made Indian urban youth more aware And I don't have the statistical data for people who are above 30, their percentage of engagement in this digital media. But predominantly, we are a young population globally. So I have taken this idea that they are successfully mobilizing issues concerning. If you look at Arab Spring, for example, that is the best example of power of digital media. You can see the Arab Spring, what happened, you know, how people mobilized opinions and what happened. You can see Anna movement, for example. It was a middle class uprising during Anna movement, and digital media had played a very serious role in mobilizing opinion. Not everyone reached Ramlila Maidan, but entire country was standing behind him. The social media has enabled us to socialize and coordinate public life from opinion and create movement and build consensus. Social media have allowed youth to explore and create their own language and assert their own identities. The process of digitization may have started as a technology revolution, but gradually it has acquired the status of a social revolution or social phenomenon that has transformed the process of socialization. Digital technologies have created a new environment which has transformed the conventional modes of communication. The new media platforms of Web 2, I mean, if you can refer to Web 1, the difference between Web 1 and Web 2 is that Web 2 has allowed you to have user-generated content. So it is truly democratic and emancipated space now we are in. And it also, you know, promotes Latour's vision of democratic emancipation through disagreement and anarchy. The magnanimity of the internet and its consequent influence on language can be understood in terms of Crystal's remark. David Crystal says that language being such a sensitive index of social change, it would be surprising indeed if such a radically innovative phenomenon did not have a corresponding impact on the way we communicate. And so it can be argued that language is at heart of internet for net activity and interactivity. The internet is not just a technological fact, it is a social fact, and the chief stock in trade is language. The new terms that has been coined in digital media, Crystal calls them net neologism. India has largest youth population. Look at these words. And you can find any corresponding, the first part is, you know, the words used in digital media, and the second part is, it can be any language. I have used Hindi compound verbs, but it can be any language. You can have Tamil, you can have Telugu, you can have Kannada, anything. So WhatsApp kar dena, status dal dena, mail kar dena, DP laga lena, text kar dena, pic send kar dena, IP pe aana, Insta pe dal dena, Snapchat karna, screenshot bhejna, tweet karna, a series of compound verbs, and I'm sure you must have corresponding things in Tamil as well, right? So what do you say to change DP? What do you say in Tamil? So you just start listing these terms in any language, right? RIP, when President Kalam unfortunately collapsed in Shillong, midnight, we started getting WhatsApp messages. And let me tell you, Manjari and Riya are sitting here, they work with me. They are the one who are making me understand these new words. Most of the time we ask them for, they are my mobile encyclopedia for this young generation language. So RIP, I started getting messages about that unfortunate death of Kalam, and then everyone wrote RIP, RIP at the end of the message. And I could not figure out, honestly, what is RIP. And almost 7 or 8 days after his death, I could decode it, and it was rest in peace. Right. Similarly, LOL, conventionally should be lots of love, but it's not that, right? What's that? You have a whole dictionary online that is called Urban Dictionary. And if you go to the Urban Dictionary, the entire idea of the term and this semantic representation changes. Frapping, for example, I saw frapping. I couldn't guess the meaning. Now, people who use Facebook know what is frapping, right? But I'm not on Facebook, by the way. So, you know, every day we are coining new words. We don't know to what extent, how long they will survive, what is the PLC, what you call in management, product like life cycle. So these are new products in language, and we don't know the life cycle, but they are prevalent these days. Now look at these three words, friend, befriend, which are familiar. What is defriend? And what is unfriend? Right? So unfriend and defriend. But they have got semantic representations. Most of you may be familiar with this name called McLuhan, and he was a Canadian philosopher in media. And this famous quote by McLuhan is global village, the term coined by McLuhan. And he said that medium is the message, right? And this is what exactly, and almost 40 years back he predicted, and we can see today. The medium underlines the fact that medium, or the media form that we are using today, creates and promotes a particular and corresponding consciousness and facilitates the reorganization of social structures. Crystal imagines a situation, and as a linguist, it is very early to predict such kind of things, but Crystal predicts that we are moving towards a homogeneous world, a linguistically homogeneous world, and then we are moving towards an ideal bilingualism where, in order to be connected with the world community, you require English, world language, which is English in this case, language of the technology, and other language will be your mother tongue to connect with local population. And for a global population or global audience, you need to have English. So English is going to supersede all other languages, and there is going to be an ideal bilingual situation. This is what Crystal predicts. And it says that it is perfectly possible to develop a situation in which intelligibility and identity happily coexist. The situation is the familiar one of bilingualism, but a bilingualism where one of the languages within the speaker is a global language, and English here in case, providing access to world community, and the other is a well-resourced regional language providing access to the local community. The two functions can be seen as complementary, responding to different needs. And it is because the functions are so different that a world of linguistic diversity can, in principle, continue to exist in a world united by a common language, and that is English. This is what Crystal's version is. Thompson observes that media have created a new kind of public sphere which is despatalized and non-dialogical in character. And if we consider it to be true, then in this non-dialogical text, the meaning is more social than textual, with many gaps which are being filled in by the viewer or the readers. McQuill puts it straight, saying that we are consequently very dependent on media for a large part of our wider symbolic environment, however much we may be able to shape our own personal versions. See, there's a theory called gratification theory in media. That says that, you know, for gratifying our needs, there are the hierarchy of needs, and for gratifying these needs, we turn to media. And another theory says that, you know, that is called, known as agenda setting theory in media, which says that media does not tell you what to think, but media definitely tells you what to think about. So this is how our perceptions and views about the surroundings are being shaped by media. It is the media which are likely to force the elements which are held in common with others, since we now tend to share much the same media sources and media culture. Without some degree of shared perception of reality, whatever its origin, there cannot really be an organized social life. If the realm of communication and the network society is characterized by a pattern of networking, flexibility, the recombination of codes and ephemeral symbolic communication. Thus, the socialization of society, the construction of a shared cultural practice that allows individuals and social groups to live together, even in conflicting togetherness, takes place nowadays in network, digitized, interactive space of communication, centered around mass media and the internet. So why I'm pointing out these things and why I'm talking about these things is that we need to understand that we are into a very early stage of a revolution, social revolution, and the digital revolution that has created a digital space which is so pervasive that we cannot imagine. I mean, today, if you say someone that you are offline, being offline is so offending, you know. I mean, you cannot imagine that you are offline, you are not connected with the network. Now, what is this network? How do we perceive this network? And why it is so essential to be in the network, right? So Copeland points out that the sociolinguistic inquiry really discusses social change, though with other perspective of change and specific interpretation of language change developed in variationist tradition are fundamental. He further remarks that sociolinguistics precludes mass media from the analysis of language change. The study of language use, language change, language maintenance, language shift in sociolinguistics gives major thrust on language aspect and seldom or never on social changes. This selective approach hardly acknowledges factors behind such language changes and analyzes data in terms of forms and patterns without looking closely at the social changes. The study of text can only be comprehensive and effective unless we look at the context in its entirety. Right? The structural change in network society has considerably affected the social, cultural, and political institutions inherited from post-industrial society. The uninterrupted supply of contents and mass consumption of information are attributing linguistic changes at a high prolific rate that cannot be overlooked or undermined in any linguistic inquiry. These structural changes become pertinent in the context of new social cultural order, which is essentially mediated by media and technology. And it is important, and this is RML, important to focus on complex relations between individual and society in the process of change that takes place in perception of what is acceptable and not acceptable linguistic practice at a social level. In order to do that, we need a more sophisticated model for language change. Basically, what I'm trying to say is that studying text is not alone important. We need to focus on context as well in which these texts are being used, because with this pervasive media and intervening digital technology, the texts, the meaning are less textual and more social. This is what I want to point out. The difference between virtual and real has blurred to the extent that collective mental experiences which are virtual have become a fundamental dimension of everybody's reality. The structured social cultural engagement is being mediated and modified by pervasive media to the effect that collective virtual experiences are being identified with by the people who may never meet in real space and time. The digitized media sphere has generated an assertive and politically charged environment for sharing, exchanging and expressing identities and their constructed meanings. The social and political radicalism, quest for collective identities and images, increasing degree of directness and are triggering changes in the language forms, and it's becoming ideologically loaded. And anonymity of cyberspace makes it easier for individuals to be rude, because the absence of face-to-face communication forces discussion that is more heated. Cyberspace actually promotes later vision of democratic emancipation through disagreement and anarchy. Such notions essentially assume interaction in a structured format that takes place in real space and time. However, the technological advancement in media and digitization of media sphere has made the identity and existence of communication partners virtual and fluid. In this sense, the scope of theoretical assumption needs to be extended to such communication events that have become a virtual reality. If society is to be taken as a context and language as text, then only any structural change in the context correspondingly affects the form and patterns of the text as well. It becomes imperative that in order to understand language forms and patterns, we need to understand the context as well. And mediating media is in communication pattern poses to be a significant factor in change of language forms and the contents. Now, if you look at the characteristics of language and the variety of language available in digital space, we can have three distinct characteristics of such texts in the media space. One is, okay, plurality. All see, if you look at the digital, the text in digital media, the written text in the real space and the written text in digital space. And when I say digital space, I'm essentially referring to social media. I'm not talking about a PDF format or a soft copy of something uploaded on the net, because that is not the text I'm talking about. I'm talking about communication in an asynchronous medium where you transcend the limits of time and space, and you know, with anonymous partners you are communicating. So this refers to one character is orality, which refers to all aspects reminiscent of casual spoken language in written discourses. And second one is compensation. So when you find gaps in such written texts, then we compensate with certain symbolic characters, what we used to call junk characters earlier. Now all the junk characters have acquired semantic representation. They have meaning. Hashtag, for example, it consists of a meaning. Emoticons was included last year in the dictionary, right? So semiotics of compensation includes any attempt to compensate for absence of facial expression or intonation patterns by the standardized means of keyboard and typeface. Compensation devices include emoticons, abbreviations that signify various types of laughter, simulations, or expressive prosody by iteration of letters and, you know, punctuation. And the third characteristics that restricts or defines language in digital media is economy. Because, for example, on Twitter, you have limited characters, right? So the structure of sentence doesn't matter. The structure of language doesn't matter. It is the message which is important, right? So linguistic economy includes any strategy of shortening the message form. This theme is most clearly predicated on technology effects attributed to necessity of speed in synchronous exchanges, to financial considerations or constraints on size of the message. Its counterpart implicit in preceding two themes is the economy of expressiveness and the tendency to contextualize exchanges as informal, engaged and jointly accomplished, drawing on means that often turn counter to linguistic economy. And I have a few observations based on my understanding of these language forms. And they are not observations, conclusive observations, because they are more in the shape of exploring questions. I don't have any answers to these observations. And I'm leaving you without any answer for you to find or fill the gap. The change in socialization process has resulted into major changes in cultural, social, and political expressions originated, shaped, and disseminated among empowered audiences in the media spaces framed by television, radio, print media, film, and web networks. The language uses in media sphere are marked with euphemism, hedging, taboo words, directness, ideologically loaded expressions, implicature, and fudginess. The notion of standard and vernacular varieties of language is politically motivated, and we call standard is one of the dominant varieties that consume the largest space and enjoy primacy in formal domains. The distinction between standard versus vernacular is getting blurred in social media and other digital platforms, which have created an emancipated democratic and user-generated context of language use without carrying a baggage of purity of language. Right, so this generation doesn't care, actually. Third observation is digital media platforms are facilitating an expansion of vernacular writing into new domains of practice and consequently a diversification of writing styles and pluralization of written language norms. This expansion is providing such vernacular written usages more space, visibility and status than ever before. Notion of face in speech act is changing in asynchronous computer-mediated communication where the face is virtual, anonymous, and ephemeral. And McLuhan's idea, medium is the message, holds true as the digital format is determining the content. You must be familiar with these words, trolling and flaming. And Anushka was trolled, when Virat Kohli, hit send us to semifinals, and Virat has to come for rescue to Anushka. Anyway, trolling, flaming trends in computer-mediated communication and language use are fueling taboo, hedging, abusive expressions being used prolifically in public sphere. Code mixing promotes linguistic creativity and reflects control of bi or multilingual mind over two or more distinct codes. The process of mixing has become a common and unmarked phenomenon in new media, and in turn creating a rich communication resource. Restrictions on time and space for typing characters reflect upon compromised conventions of writing and overall grammatical forms. Impact of social media and other digital platforms may appear negligible in spoken language. However, we need to understand that this is just the beginning. The trend and practices in social media are definitely setting the agenda and dominating discourse. New media configuring the social order, redefining social roles, influencing our images and associations, and consequently legitimizing our newly discovered identities. Digital media has created a democratic and flexible space for engagement and sharing. We are constructing meaning in multilateral and all-directional media platforms. The boundary between virtual and real space is diffusing and creating new sites with real-time virtuality for constructing knowledge. User-generated contents and appropriation of information are becoming unmarked phenomenon. Uncontrolled and unsolicited messages supplied by multiple digital sources, much beyond the capacity to consume, are consequently creating an information overload. It becomes imperative that traditional linguistic theories in general and sociolinguistic theories in particular extend their scope for capturing this space. The process of digitization has become a social phenomenon, and the content available in this space is new linguistic reality. Then the centrality of language cannot be undermined, and linguistics as well as other disciplines must take charge of analyzing and theorizing this phenomenon. In addition, we also require to negotiate with other allied disciplines such as psychology, sociology, and media studies. We need to engage sociolinguistic inquiry in a broader and accommodating way so that such changes in context of language use may correspondingly account for changes in language forms. In order to understand changing language forms and patterns, we need to engage in ever-changing context as well. And in this sense, media sphere becomes a dynamic source of data and anything for anything sociolinguistic inquiry. And there is a need to take into account such structural changes in society, which, while understanding changes in language forms and their use in context, the context of language use has never been so dynamic and complex as it is the case now. The existing sociolinguistic theories and concepts need to be revisited in accommodating these structural changes in order to explain this trend in language use in media sphere and bring core linguistic inquiry into peripheral space of such texts in use. Thank you.
My question is, when someone logs onto the internet for the first time, and the internet is a vast space, I mean, you would never find the end of the internet. Because there are different corners to the internet, I mean, it's probably not right to say corners to the internet, but different faces to the internet, and each facet has their own particular lingo, right? And I don't see how that is particularly democratic, because it is up to the user who visits these particular places to educate themselves, and otherwise they are alienated, and it becomes a space which is not accessible. And I don't see how the internet is viewed as a democratic space in that respect.
There are two levels at which we can approach, one micro level and one macro level. When I say democratic space, I mean to say that internet has created digital platforms where even the minor voices can find space, and if you can opine and you can express yourself. As far as the as you said that there are compartmentalized spaces where very close groups have different lingos. Of course, we need to understand that we live in a very diverse world. And internet is not a homogenizing factor that homogenizing everything. The diversity will remain. And I mean, you have multiple groups. And if you look at the whole idea of trolling, for that matter, or flaming, for that matter, that is very undemocratic. That is very undemocratic, right? It is undemocratic. But that is there. But at a macro level, internet is or digital platforms are giving you a space for engagement, which was never the case earlier. If you look at political socialization, for example, there is a theory called the spiral of silence. And this theory says that, you know, a spiral of silence, we remain silent because we have the fear of being cornered as minority voice. So this keeps on spiraling. But now internet has given you that democratic space where you can voice your concerns, you can participate in discussions. And see, there is a hell lot of chaos on the internet, actually, because it is in its nascent stage and it is in the beginning. So a lot of chaos is there. But I believe that pattern emerges out of a chaos. You may find certain undemocratic characteristics of the internet, but of course it has given you a platform to voice, right, your opinion. So let us hope that in future, because the pattern will definitely emerge. It may be chaotic at the beginning.
What is that when you referred to David Crystal's, right? Crystal, you said, so David Crystal's hypothesis, in a way, that we are going, since we are in a globalized world, we are ultimately probably going to end up being bilinguals, with the English being the global language, and then we have all these mother tongues. I think that may be a possibility. However, I think that is really bad for the
system. This is not a possibility at all.
Let me complete. I think there's a contradiction there, right? Because the system itself, even though while you're going towards a globalized world, you also tend to get profit from these localized economies, right? You turn them into tourist spots. You also kind of, for instance, I feel that a lot of these studies done by American universities in proper departments of linguistics, in a sense, are making showpieces of the remaining speakers of American Indian languages, right? People, tribes, which have been targeted by them, and which have very few speakers. So I think there's a contradiction. That's one thing that I would like to hear your observation on. The second is, I also think as linguists, we tend to, we have seen it, that there is a huge amount of variation which happens, probably also because we have all these socio-cultural factors. But even otherwise, there is something in our language ability or whatever where we are always changing our language. So even if English becomes a globalized language and the only language, we'll see a lot of varieties of Indian of English, right? And there are multiple books which show that you have many, many varieties of English. So there is always this contradiction. I think as linguists, we probably need to point that out as well. So maybe we could think of this together as to how with technology trying to globalize us, trying to narrow down our options, there is also a counter force that is happening, probably as part of our genetic endowment, part of the very new human nature that we have, that we are also counteracting that. We are going against the trend.
Yes.
So that's one thing. So the third thing, I think, because you mentioned saying that there are these, you would like linguistic theories to look into these kinds of new forms that are coming out. I think one is that all these forms are at the morphological level. I don't think syntax is affected, right?
It's very early to say that. The influence of this kind of digital language in digital media is negligible in terms of spoken language and written language. But if you look at the structures in Twitter posts, for example, you see little variations in syntax, but that is almost negligible. But the process has started. I don't know how long it would take to see the real change in syntactic structures. How long it will take, but the process has started.
Right. I mean, for instance, if you write in English and if you lose out on some of, let's say, you don't want to repeat or write the inflectional markings.
Yes.
You will still make sure that you have Virat and Anushka at the right places, right?
Right.
So if you know that Anushka has fallen out of love with Virat, you wouldn't like to put her in the subject position.
Right.
So as long as you know the word order and the syntax of your spoken language, I think that affects your your SMS or whatever Twitter account, you're definitely going to take care of some basic structure, right? Otherwise, so one interesting point of study, and maybe if someone is interested even in the audience, is to find out to what extent can we go when we write? What amount of variation can happen? So what is the point of divergence between right. spoken and written language? Right. So we are definitely being very careful when we write, but it's not that kind of textual language anymore. And I think that's the entire value of your kind of research, where you're showing that it's no longer like a more formalized version of your spoken language. Yes, you're actually going against it. But to what extent? Right. I think that would be a good point. And maybe
the whole idea of digitization is too young to even see the predictable changes. Or you can predict on such a small set of data. But what I try to emphasize is that process has begun. And let us see to what extent they will be able to change. See, for that Debye-Crystal factor, the whole idea of Debye-Crystal about this English is misnomer, I feel, as a linguist. Because there's nothing called English, or English, or the English. So even if you start, you know, speaking English, everyone starts speaking English, and English becomes language of technology, exclusively language of technology, still we'll have hundreds of varieties of English. So in that sense, we are not homogeneous at all. And digital media is also giving you space for this vernacular, so-called in quotes. I don't consider vernacular to be an in quotes. This digital media is giving you space to give prominence to such varieties which never got space in the formal public domain. So that is one beautiful thing happening on the internet. You can document them, they're being documented, they're being, and people are deriving identity and pride out of it. So that is a good thing happening to promote diversity.
We are in India and we have, Ambedkar Jayanti, right?
Yes.
Today, right? It may be a worthwhile exercise for some of us linguists out here to look at the impact that our constitution, especially the 8th schedule, has had on language variation.
Yes.
Right? On language variation, on recognizing vernaculars. So on one side, you have media giving space to vernaculars, as you say. I don't know to what extent. But on the other side, the presence of recognized languages within the 8th schedule, right, tells us that we are not supposed to look at vernaculars. And even if we do, we have to consider them as dialects, right? So maybe that contradiction that exists in our polity, and then the technology coming from the government itself, right? They are the ones who are also forcing
this. That is my point, because in a formal way, you have accepted 22 languages as standard formal languages enlisted in its schedule. But technology is defying this counting, and today you find posts in almost, though the script may be Roman, you may have Roman script for languages which do not have their own script. But you find posts and sharing and socialization process, the entire political socialization process. Go to Assam, for example, and see. It's the news in mainstream media, in print media, on television, on radio. You have political discourses and debates and discussions, all in standard Assamese. But if you look at the FB posts, if you look at one of my students has, I'm not on FB, Facebook, but I get to see the posts. Because she brings me data from there. And you can see the posts there are not in standard Assamese, for example. And the digital space is so heated, and the arguments are so heated, choked with emotions, and at times becomes difficult to get meaning out of it. But what beautiful thing about it is that digital media is giving them a platform to voice. And that diversity, is being promoted in digital media, which is very good thing about it.
Two things. One, regarding the democratization process that happens through social media. Like what ma'am said, and what you said, the vernacular and its getting standardization. It is mainly, I think it can be attributed to the absence of an editor too.
Absence of?
An editor.
Editor?
In any other form of media, you have an editor. An editor who gatekeeps, but here you have no gatekeeper, and therefore the language, it's completely up to your liberty how to use the language. So the absence of an editor is also a reason.
See, if you refer to the first part of the talk, I said that Web 2 is different from Web 1, because Web 2 has allowed us to have user-generated content. So we are not passive consumers of information now. because we are the one who are creating. So we are creating and consuming, and this consumption and creation of information is going hand in hand. As far as appropriation and censorship and editing is concerned, that is why I call it in a democratic space, because you know, you do not have any sanction, you do not have censorship, you do not have editing. So you have an idea and you have expression and you have a space to express that.
Imagine the scenario when the social media becomes obsolete.
Okay,
say,
yeah.
Let's take the example of Orkut.
Yes.
Or take the example of pager and even SMS to an extent. While SMS was prominent, I mean the regular text. So when it was prominent, we used, you know, U for YOU. And I think we still use it. But with the advent of swipe, you know, the swipe facility lets you, you know, type the actual word without much, much work.
Now you have voice text.
Yeah. So how much of the change is actually, you know, going to stay around?
See,
the language change that we say.
My interest is not in technology, because I know that the PLC, what we call product life cycle, product life cycle of these IT products are so short that if Samsung launches one tab today, after 10 months it becomes obsolete. That's a life cycle, you know. It's unlike other conventional telephones, which stood for us for the last 50 years, but they cannot sustain even 50 months. So my interest is not technology. Technology will keep on changing. That is the only constant characteristics of this thing. My interest is that this changing technology and impact on language forms. So even if technology changes, SMS becomes obsolete, all these social media platforms or digital media platforms that you have today, you'll have a different technology altogether. Language will remain.
But the factor that decides the social media, the new or the existing, will keep changing, and accordingly the lingo change also will change. I mean to say that presently the language change that we observe today is persisting to the media that we have. So the change that we observe is not, you know, I think it's too young to be studied upon. It keeps changing.
That's what I'm saying, it's too early to predict.
Exactly.
But I'm trying to underline the fact that we need to pay attention to it.
Sure.
As a linguist. Because language forms are changing, contexts are changing, and of course, technology will definitely change. Technology is not going to remain forever, any technology.
Yeah, just a small observation. I've recently read this book called Twitterature, and this was by two Stanford University students. They've rewritten the entire, starting from whether it's Shakespeare to the latest J.K. Rowling's texts. They've stuck to the Twitter structure and they've written it in 140 characters, and it's too easy to read. I don't know, all of us, you know, we consider certain texts very sacrosanct when we read our Jane Austen and Hardy, all these classics. But then when they've redone the entire thing, it also poses a lot of questions to us as language users and language generators, because we've read so many versions of Shakespeare, starting from the Marxist, feminist, psychoanalytic, you know, different reversions have been done, whether it is the performance or different drafts have been done. Now, this particular kind of rendition also needs to be given little interest and probed into. Because what they've done is they've rewritten the entire text, and I don't know, when you read it, it's just on your face and it stops within that 140 characters. And I think it takes a lot of control and mastery over a particular language to be doing that kind of a job. So as linguists, I'm just thinking aloud whether this is a digital version or this is a futuristic kind of a version of a classic or what is it like? I'm just thinking aloud. I'm sure we are familiar with the text that I'm...
I think there is no question, right?
Okay.
It's not a question.
No, it's not a question.
No,
I'm
a
just
question.
Telling
of course.
You. Whether so it's a digitized, futuristic version.
That's what I pointed out, that when you look at the economies, orality, compensation, and economy.
Yeah, economy factor.
The characters which define language in digital media. 140 characters. And the idea that you have...
Letters.
No, not only letters, even the full stop and the comma.
Yeah, the alphabet or the symbol.
Alphabet.
The character that you type, man. Every character that is typed or keyed in. A space also, I think, is included.
Yes. Of course, I mean, lots of creativity are there. And
every press of this.
Press of in a keyboard. Yes. Every press of keyboard, whatever you get on as a response on the screen is a character.
It's not a question to him. It's like when you pointed out, it's an observation on like what you said. I just my thinking and my idea on that. like you said, okay, you, now we are using, instead of Y-O-U, we use just you. Now, for me, yes, it's not too early, it's not a too early a thing to change, yes. It's too early to predict, right, but not too early to read it or research on it. Because if we take, like, history and the great vowel shift and how it happened, so wif became wife and whose became house, and we have started accepting it. Or mathematics, maths was one time a slang, and now we are like, so it was mathematics, and all of a sudden it became maths, and that was a slang. So we never know, 20 years down the line, or 10 years, like 30 years down the line, the spelling would be, instead of love, you would be writing love. So the spelling would change from love, L-O-V-E, to L-U-V, and then maybe 50 years down the line, we would start, instead of saying love, we would say love, and then read, and then the linguist then would read, okay, initially it was called love, and now it's pronounced as love. So it's not, it's early to predict, but it's not early to study this, because this is a change, and I think the social media, it's not the network society or internet, it is the social media that is responsible for a language change. And change is the only constant.
I asked him about whether you are talking about neuro-linguistic programming or natural language processing.
Okay.
So he was interested in natural language processing. That means TCS is already developing a kind of software which is going to replace all the personnel in the call centers. Mm-hmm. That means it will be reacting to all the questions we are going to ask, mostly the technical questions, you know. So there is a kind of standardization taking place through technology. When the machine takes over, there will be a worldwide standardized language. But when you're expressing our emotions as human beings, that tend to change, because otherwise we'll bore to death if you use the same language. So there may be two types of languages, one standardized for language, for technology and business, another for human emotions.